I got to be honest with you. Because I always, when I interpret this verse, I always will say, well, a lot of places can be your secret closet. You know, I'm driving to work. I'm praying while I'm driving to work. That's my secret closet. I'm on the bus and I got, you know, I'm listening to my music. I can pray then. That's my secret closet. Or even at work when I'm closing my office door sometimes, that can be my secret closet. But here, I want you to tell you something. I stand convicted because that's not good enough. If God says this is the second most important principle of prayer, first, don't pray like the hypocrites. Second, have a secret closet. If he's lifting it up this as this importance in the Sermon on the Mount, then it's very clear that this is an important thing to do. And so what did Jesus do? When Jesus had serious stuff to talk to the Father about, he left the disciples, he went up to the mountaintop all by himself, and he prayed. His secret closet was on the top of the mountaintop, isolated. He's like, Peter, you can't even go up here with me on this. John, you got to stay on down there with him. Because I got my own time with my Heavenly Father. He did it constantly, throughout the Gospels. He constantly would steal away and do that very thing. So Jesus is saying to us, we need to be very clear about where our secret closet is. We can't just do it in the car while we listen to gospel music. Because sometimes when we listen to gospel music, we listen to the song and listen to the music, or we listen to the words, and we ain't praying at all. There's something about the idea of making it an area where there's nothing but prayer, where there is no distractions, where there is nothing but you and God, and you got to meet God, because the devil will try to trick you. In the movie, the young lady, when she started to try her secret closet, she just went into her closet. Well, her closet had all her clothes in it. And her closet had all her shoes in it. And her closet didn't have a comfortable chair, so she tried to find a pillow. Then she brought some food in with her because she said, I'm hungry. And after a while, she's looking at the shoes. She's looking at the clothes. She eating ice cream. She doing everything but talking to God. I'm like, oh, somebody help me now. Because I know I've been there at times where I try to go into the secret closet and I'm bringing everything with me and I'm distracted after 5 minutes. Can't even really pray to God because I'm thinking about the things instead of thinking about God. Yeah, good enough. See, now y'all all feel convicted because y'all looking at me right now. Okay. Pastor, why you talking about me like that? Didn't I say I did my conviction here? All right then, so I'm feeling this way. I know some of y'all feeling this too. But the reality is, for you to really spend time with God, it's going to be you and God. God says over and over, I speak in a small, still voice. He meant what he said. And if you got ice cream, and you're looking at some shoes, and you're looking at your clothes, and you're trying to get comfortable in the chair, small, still voice of God that is directing you to tell you exactly how to handle every enemy in your life.
Yes.
You can't, we can't possibly miss God's voice, because when you miss God's voice, you're going to miss God. So you've got to be able to understand your instructions in the war room. You've got to be able to understand God's strategy for your life in the war room. You've got to be able to do what God tells you in the war room, because God is the strategist. God is the general. God is the lieutenant. God is somebody help me.
I told you I'm
going to hit this for another 10 minutes. I'm done. Because I want you to get this. And there's one point I want you to get. Is this tomorrow, today, when you get home, what room am I going to pick? Today, when you go in there, what place? I need to throw this stuff out a long time ago anyway. What am I going to pick as my room? What place in my house? What place in my apartment? What place in where I'm staying at right? What place, no matter where I'm living at right now, am I going to find a place? And if you live with somebody else or you're living in some other place, you got to ask somebody, I need to find a place to pray. Can you tell me a place in which I can pray, in which I can share my heart and soul with God? I need a place of solitude. I need a place where I can be by myself. I need a place where I can just talk to him one-on-one. Give me an opportunity. Let me find a place. Will you show me a place? It's that critical. Because a warrior without a war room is a losing warrior. Because you don't have any strategies. And you're sure not applying any strategies. You just walking in life getting hit. To take the analogy all the way out, you're seeing stuff come to you. All kinds of things being shot your way. And the attitude of most of us is just to keep walking. All kinds of slings and arrows are coming. The enemy's attacking us on every side. We just keep walking. Ooh. Ooh. I mean, come on. And God is saying there's strategies so you can duck that thing. I could have told you, if you were listening to me, that was going to come your way. If you heard the strategy that I wanted to share with you, you would have known. And you would have missed that situation. But instead, it hit you in the head because you didn't hear what God was trying to say. I know there's been too many times in my life the stuff that hit me inside my head. And I said, what happened? How did I get in this situation?
Close the door.
And you don't you know why? in mind, your mind, because I can't solve your problems and you can't solve mine. I gotta get up in the war room with the one who can solve my problems and handle my situation and get, let me get before him and give me a strategy and get out of the mess that I'm in. Come on, a couple more minutes. You got to hear that in the spirit. Because some of us right now, we're struggling even with this message. We're struggling with even this text. Does it really take all of that? Yes. 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 And it's critical. Think of the next big decision you have to make. Don't you know you got an enemy that's trying to give you four or five different options?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All of them that will lead you to hell.
Yes, sir. Come on,
yes. Don't you see that the enemy is whispering also in your ear to give you every option that will lead you and mess you up? And you're not spending any time with the Lord to get the right option. And here it is. But I'll go to my friends or go to my counselors who will give me good advice. But no, they might be hearing from the same hell here as well. It's all you get advice from somebody else who heard from the devil who's giving you the devil's advice. They don't mean for it to be the devil's advice, but it is because they can ask God. Lord, have mercy. And so sometimes God will give you advice that don't make any sense. Don't take that job. I'm broke. Don't take that job. God, you didn't hear me. I'm broke. And here comes somebody who's a heavy, Lord have mercy, because they've been listening to the devil and I've been listening to God. Remember, God called Peter that. He said, get behind me, O Satan, because Peter for a moment was listening to the devil and wasn't listening to God. So it can happen to even holy people. And so he, you told your friends, oh, should I take this job?
You ain't got no money. You need to take this job. You broke. You need to take this job.
And so you're like, well, my friends think I should do it. I ain't got no money. My pocket said I should do it. Oh, I don't take this job. Not knowing that God, a month later, had exactly the job you need waiting for you, only if you had trusted him not to take that other opportunity. But see, only God can tell you. Only God can show you what other people can't solve. So even good folk can lead you to a strategy, to state strategy, if you not got a war room to go to spend time with God. For yourself and nobody else. Get your war. Ephesians chapter 6 puts it this way, and I'm closing. He said, Ephesians chapter 6 said, get your war room so you can stand up against the wiles of the devil. Get your war room so that you fight against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places. Get your war room. Get your war room so you can put your war room armament on. So you can grab the breastplate of righteousness. You can grab a helmet of salvation. Yeah? You can be able to grab and get your loins girded about the truth. Get in your war room so you can get your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Get in your war room so you can be able to get the shield of faith to quench all the fiery darts of the devil. Get in the war room and you can be able to deal with the devil in every way.
Yeah.
There's one more that at home, sir. There's no preparation for war till you get yourself a war.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We'll be talking about this in the next 6 weeks in so many different ways. That's right. To win the fight, you gotta have the right strategy and the right resources. Because victories don't come by accident. That's what's up on the screen. And that's real. Victories don't come by accident. They come by a strategy, a heavenly strategy of the Lord. Let's take off our feet, right? Good morning, ministers. We're going to open the doors of the church right here. I'm tired of losing stuff. Lord, there are children lost. I'm tired of seeing the saints of God getting their behind, can't be very much away, and then coming to me later and say, Pastor, what went wrong? I'm tired of hearing the saints of God who know the word of God. They're coming in defeated, beat back by the laws of the ways of life. I'm tired. Oh, come on, brother. 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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Just pray with me right now. Pray with me right now. Pray with me. You want to pray with me right now. Praise the Lord. Pray with me. Doors of the church are open. They're open. Because I want to see you victorious. I want to see you coming to me and saying, Pastor, I got my secret closet and I prayed. And don't you know where all the debt they said I owed, I don't even know where it was. I can't figure it out. I know I owe it. I keep my count of what I owe. But they said I don't owe none of it anymore. I want to hear that victory. I want to hear that victory that God said, is there anything too hard for God? That my God will supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. When you try to lift up those kind of verses up in your boardroom and you watch God for yourself make great things happen in your life. I want to hear the victories. Come on, somebody. It's all right, brother. You hear 8 o'clock, that's cool. Come up again, it's all right, brother. That's it. All praise this day. I'm tired of hearing young people say, oh, well, I could have did this or I could have did that differently. No, you need your war room. In the movie, the daughter who was only 8 years old had her own war room. Started lifting up her prayers in her closet, praying for a family, praying for a father and mother to get along. And every time God did it, she checked it off. Say, Mama, God answered prayer. You need to have yourself a war room. Lord have mercy. If an 8-year-old can have a war room, certainly a 58 or 68-year-old person ought to have a war room too. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. And as you write down your prayers and start to lift them up to God, just between you and God, keep it either count in a book or count on the wall. And make sure you check off everyone that God has done. Lord have mercy. God will do it. God will do it. Doors of the church have been open. All those who want to know Christ. If you do not know Jesus Christ and the pardon of your sins, why don't you take a step out in the aisle and come to him today. Come to him today.